So we've just spent a whole chapter talking about the gas state, and there's a whole lot of laws, Boyle's law, Charles' law, ideal gas law, a lot of calculations that we can do that interrelate how gases behave. Now we're going to look at the other two states of matter. We're going to look at the liquid state and the solid state, and we also spend time talking about the interconversion between those states and include gases when we have those conversations. So let's just look at the three states here for just a minute as a group. Okay, so we see on the screen there the gas, the liquid, and the solid, and we have some properties given to us for water. Now, I don't want you to memorize those numbers, but I do want you to kind of look at the values, and we can draw some conclusions about the difference between the three states, what they're doing on the molecular level. So we know what a solid is, a liquid is, and a gas is by way of, you know, solids have a defined shape and a defined volume. Liquids have a defined volume but not shape. They can take on the shape of their container, and gases expand to fill whatever size or shape container it's in. So we know that that is how we, on the macroscopic level, on the level that we can see, we define those three states. But let's look down in the molecular level and let's start looking at what's happening with the molecules. So let me look at this a little bit and let's do some comparisons. Okay, we can see on the molecular level that the gases are very, very far apart. Now, this is not even to scale here, because if the molecule was that big, the next one wouldn't fit on the screen anywhere, but there's great distances between them. In the liquid state, they are touching each other, and they're moving about, able to move past each other and flow past each other. And in the solid state, they are packed in tightly as well, but cannot freely move past each other. The big difference between these properties is in their density. The density of liquid water and ice are about the same, but when you get down to that of a gas, it is way smaller. And this is going to be true for all gases. All gases will be way far, far less dense in the gas phase than they are in the liquid and the solid phase. Now, in terms of the density of liquid water and solid ice, okay, the fact that ice is less dense than water is very unusual. Okay, it's very unusual for that to be the case. Most solids are more dense and would sink in their liquid state, but water doesn't do that. But again, this one is the one that we need to always realize is going to be true. Now, that is just some general properties about solids, liquids, and gases. I really want you to think about that thing that I've got a box around and what we see on the molecular level. So what was going to make the difference between these things? We're going to get into the kinetic molecular theory of liquids and gases, where we talked about this for, solids and liquids. We talked about this for gases already. But what we know about solids and liquids is that they're considered the condensed state because they are packed very, very closely together. Once again, if we go back to what we saw here, it's condensed because they're very, very close together, pushed closely together. There's an attraction that's holding them together we're going to talk about here as we go on. Okay, so it's called condensed states. The liquid state, we see that the molecules are close together, there's very little empty space. It's difficult to compress. It's difficult to make them get into a very much smaller space than they already are. Now, what we're going to learn about today is attractive forces that hold these things together. If they're very, very close together, which it says they are, if they're very close together, there's something that's holding them close together, and that's attractive forces. We already knew this from way back in chapter 1. Liquids have a defined volume. And in terms of what they're doing in the kinetic molecular theory, let's think about those words. Molecules, movement. This is the molecules are moving, okay? So how do they move? In the liquid state, they can move past each other freely, and this is what allows liquids to flow. Now, a little bit about solids. They're rigidly held in place. Now, they might be rigidly held in place in a very organized way or a disorganized way, but their neighbors stay their neighbors. They're even less compressible than liquids, meaning you can't push them any closer together and you start smashing on them. They just change shapes if they can. Usually, like I said in the first slide, usually the solid is more dense than the liquid. They get compacted even more tightly together, and this makes them more dense because they're packed more tightly together. And again, what we learned way back in chapter one is that they have a definite shape and a definite volume. Now, what we see as an image on the screen here is the difference between what's called a crystalline solid and an amorphous solid. So a crystalline solid is going to have a molecular arrangement that's very well organized, a strong order to them. So we see that happening in a two-dimensional array, but this is going to go back in three dimensions as well. So the neighbors are going to, you know, be nicely organized and packed together. There's a lot of different ways they are packed together, but we'll learn about that much later. So we have our crystalline solid, and if there isn't this well-defined three-dimensional order, they are called amorphous solids. And amorphous solids, really that's all we're going to say about them. They don't have any long-range order. We'll talk more about the crystalline structure as we proceed through this chapter and as well as chapters in later semesters. Now, instead we're going to talk about the three states of matter, we're also going to be talking about the interconversion between those three states of matter. So we need to keep in mind how we interconvert. If we start with a solid, let's say for example we start with ice, we know that if we increase the temperature, what we're doing is we're putting in what we call thermal energy. Thermal energy is added and they start moving faster. And as they move faster, they are able to break apart their attractions from each other. And in the liquid state, they're still somewhat attracted to each other, and that's why they're held together. But we can keep on adding and keep on adding more and more thermal energy, and eventually they will lose their attraction whatsoever, and they will have nothing holding them together, and they're moving totally independent of each other. So that's what happens when we raise the temperature, moving from ice to water to steam. But that would be true for any solid to liquid to gas. It is never going to go from a solid, it's never going to go from a liquid, add heat, and it turn into a solid. It'll always move in this direction. Now there's this little thing down here which says increasing IMF going this way. We're going to talk about what that intermolecular force is later. So that concludes our introduction to the three states of matter and our interconversion between those three states. We're going to start on our lessons about intermolecular force next.